Welcome back to our morning show. I am joined by my colleague Sebo Apollo Mubiru.
Yes.
Welcome.
All right, thank you.
And we are also going to have an expert on pandemics coming on here to answer a few questions on the coronavirus. This is Dr. Monica Musenero. Dr. Monica Musenero is an expert on public health, and she is known for her heroic efforts in Sierra Leone when she fought alongside other doctors to fight against Ebola. And she was actually given the name Konya to mean female warrior. We hope that she can be our heroic person as we fight the pandemic. Dr. Musenero, you are welcome to this set. Good morning.
Thank you.
We hope you can be our warrior. Can you be our warrior during this pandemic?
I'm trying.
You're trying. Thank you very much for trying.
I'm doing my best.
Okay. We're going to go straight to the questions today. What is this new strain that we are hearing about? What is this new strain?
I think.
Lynn, viruses change. Mm-hmm. It is characteristic of viruses to keep changing because they are so small.
Okay.
They keep changing. And even in Uganda, we don't have like the very only one, but those changes are usually so small that the virus behaves the same, it causes the same disease, spreads the same way. But the time comes once in a while when the change is enough and the virus changes its behavior.
Okay, but we are seeing we are seeing countries being worried, for example, in the UK with the strain that's there. They are worried that it could actually spread and cause more havoc. We see that flights have been banned in the UK. And also in South Africa right now, the strain that is there, it's saying that it's infecting people. They're saying it's 70% more infectious. And also Nigeria has detected the same strain that is in South Africa. Should we be worried about this in Uganda?
Yes, definitely we must be worried. The good news is that although this strain apparently spreads faster, following up the science closely why it is able to spread faster, I think what it means is that maybe you need fewer particles of virus to get sick from it, to get infected with it. Because the one which has been there has been like, you know, you can be with someone who has COVID, and a few times many people have come close, person you were with, but you didn't get it. But now this one seems to be more efficient in infecting people, and it is overtaking, it's quickly replacing the one which was there. At the moment, all the studies, all the reports do not show that this is causing a more severe disease. However, there are things that we need to worry about. The things we need to worry about is if this virus becomes more and it can cause more severe disease, that one we need to worry about it, because even that one will keep changing. So if it can spread faster, if it acquires ability to cause severe disease, then that one becomes really bad. We also worry about it changing enough such that people who have already fallen sick with the old version of the virus, they become sick again from this one. Mm-hmm. And because they can become sick again if the virus has changed enough such that the antibodies in the old virus don't fully recognize this one, so it can escape and cause disease. So if that happens, it hasn't yet been reported, but if it happens, then it kind of slows our ability to build up the herd immunity. You have heard about the herd immunity.
Yes,
meaning
yes,
that
heard about it.
Who had been infected, who we know are less susceptible for a time, it may not be so. You could fall sick from the old one and fall sick from a new one. These are things we are worrying about. The third issue we are worried about is this virus, the changes are becoming too fast ahead of the vaccine. That means that we have to really re-engineer the vaccine. The good thing is in Uganda, we are learning about this as we are still in the process of really putting together the components.
Yeah, and also, we have heard that, we've heard that some medical experts yesterday were saying we currently do not have the kits to test for this new variant virus. So how quickly can we get these test kits into the country, and how much will they cost the government?
That we don't have the what, the test?
Yeah, the test kits for the new variant. If we have to test for the new variant, we don't have the test kits.
Yeah, because it is just imaged. But we can, we will try to make that very quickly.
Mm-hmm.
We'll try to get that very quickly. Okay, because we are starting producing our PCR kits in January. We are delayed a bit because of machines, but once we have our domestic capacity, it should be very easy. Now, the thing is, at the moment, if you notice, while in the Western world, with the coming of the second wave, the reaction of most countries has been lockdown. If you notice, most African countries have not locked down.
Mm-hmm.
Because in the Western world, they locked down in winter and spring, and many opened up as they moved to late spring and summer and autumn.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Uganda has only one weather. If we lock down again, we are going to lock down forever because our weather is that. Many African countries have not responded by lockdown. Now, this virus is going to spread the same way the other one spread.
Okay.
So unless everybody bans transport, just stopping flights going to UK, it can slow down the virus from coming, but it cannot stop it. Because
okay,
what stops me from leaving UK, going to another country, and then somehow the virus will spread. So we need to use more science to prepare for it, detect it,
mm-hmm,
monitor it, and address it.
Yes, Dr. Msenero, can one fall victim of the two types of the virus at the same time, or one type should come after the other?
At the moment, it will depend on which virus you have got. And so far, there is no evidence that these two viruses are different in terms of the way they affect your immune system. So if you are exposed to two people who have different variants and they are infecting you at the same time, then it is possible, although it's rare, it is possible. But because we don't yet have the evidence that you can get this one, start the infection, and then go to hospital and pick a second one, because so far they are still antigenically similar. That means the immune response to the old one can protect you a bit from the new one. But that is again to emphasize that we need to double up our SOPs. We need to double up our masks. We need to double up our social distancing, because otherwise now we are going to get a complex of things.
Mm-hmm. And talking about doubling our efforts in fighting the coronavirus currently, the parent strain we currently have in the country, we've seen that not many people are adhering to the SOPs. People are actually ignoring these SOPs. They've been told don't travel up country for Christmas. People are traveling up country for Christmas. They've been told to wear their masks. People are not wearing their masks. What do you think we can do as a nation to actually beat this? Some people have actually suggested deploying military, deploying police, to police 45 million Ugandans and tell them, look, you have to wear your masks, you have to do this. What do you think we can do as a country to get on top of things regarding this disease?
The first thing then is, if you must go home for Christmas, then take a gift of masks.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, instead of carrying any other thing, the best thing you can carry for them is masks. Of course, for me, I'm telling you, don't go, because our settlement system, you know, most of our elderly people are not in cities, they're in villages.
Mm.
Now, our settlement system was kind of protecting them, because most of their people who are out, they're in town, and when usually people go to visit these elderly, they will sit, you know, some distance. Naturally, they will not spend a lot of time with them.
Mm-hmm.
But now we are carrying families to go and stay with them for a week or two inside. And the chance that we shall exchange viruses is very high.
Yes.
That's why we have been advising people don't travel. So after this, we are going to see a penetration of the virus.
Mm-hmm.
Although for now, you've seen most of the cases were coming from Kampala. But coming up towards end of January, February, we shall see a lot of cases coming mm-hmm. from the rural areas of the okay. country. And there we are going to have a lot of vulnerable people mm-hmm. who are infected, and they don't have access to care, as good care as those who can get access to Mulago. So that's why we are pleading with people, if possible, don't travel. Mm-hmm. If you must travel, then carry, but you know, teaching people to wear masks takes a long time.
Yes.
And they will not wear it consistently. So mm-hmm. the best thing is send what you can send and don't go until we have handled this scourge. It's better not to see your parents for a few months than mm-hmm. not to see them forever.
Okay, Dr. Msenero, a lot of talk is on about COVID and speculations are all over the place. But we wanted to get it from you as a medic. Is it clinically true that after one recovers from the virus, chances of having it again are slim?
So far, we have had a few individuals going back and testing positive. But we did not have the capacity, we did not test whether that is the same virus or they got a different virus. My high suspicion is the majority just hadn't cleared the virus. At the time they were being tested, possibly the virus was not in the place where we were picking the specimen. Globally, they have reported a few cases of reinfection. So in the immediate, like 6 months, the monitoring which has been going on, we see the antibodies going down. But in that immediate, many people recover, have very high antibodies, and we've not seen a lot of people coming back in sick. Now, that indicates that at least in the early, the first 6 months, 6 to 8 months, which is the experience that we have had, those individuals do not get infected again. However, we cannot say this will last for all their entire life. Mm-hmm. But the evidence there is that when you recover, you are relatively protected. But how long you're protected and whether the new strain can overcome that protection, we don't yet know. But UVRI has been monitoring the different strains of virus that we have in Uganda, and it's still quite relatively stable. We have, there are a few mutations, but it is still quite stable. But soon we'll have the capacity to monitor, to monitor them, so and develop the tests to make sure that we are detecting in clinical samples. Because monitoring the virus strain is a bit expensive, because mm-hmm. you have to do what we call sequence, but once we see that accumulation, we should be able to make changes in the kit so that we can detect it in yeah. the clinical samples.
Yeah, and also on a concerning note, medics in the country, especially in upcountry centers, are beginning to show concern. They're expressing concern that they are beginning to lose control of the virus and how to track the people who are infected and just go into the community and look for these people. What do you have to say about that? Because it looks like the virus could actually just go out of hand. And especially now, like we've said, people are heading back to the villages and coming back to the city center. So do you think our health system can still handle this, or do you think at this point we are just, you know, it's out of our hands?
It's really at the brink. It's at the brink, and I am hoping that many people will listen to all the pleas and all the calls and all the advice, because we have a very dangerous mix now. We have the dangerous mix of Christmas and politics and COVID. Those three ingredients can result into disaster. So at the phase where we are in the epidemic, it's not even possible for government to effectively enforce, because mm-hmm. you only enforce a law which most people obey, and there are only a few people who are breaking. It's very difficult to enforce a law which everybody is breaking and only a few people are observing. Mm-hmm. But this is for our own good, and the health facilities definitely are going to get they're already overwhelmed anyway with these cases. We are not able to keep up with the testing, so in phase four we change, test only the sick people, people who don't have symptoms, and what if you pay, people want to travel. We are hoping that with the introduction of the new test kits, we should be able to increase that testing. But still, we are going to depend on how you and I respond to the call of social distancing, the call of not going out, the call of wearing your mask, and the call of hand hygiene. If we don't do that, there is practically nothing we can do globally. UK has put up one of the strictest lockdowns that they have had. Now, over Christmas, they have put up very, very strict lockdown. But we'll not put a lockdown now on Uganda because, as I told you, we are one season throughout the year. That means locking down throughout the year.
Also, that means we expect to see more deaths in the country going forward, especially if we do not make a U-turn regarding, you know, respecting SOPs.
Okay.
Definitely, we are going to see more deaths, especially towards end of January, February, early March. We are going to see, you will see, not everybody will be confirmed as COVID because they will not be able to reach those people to test them. But you just observe an increase in the rate of death, especially among the elderly.
Doctor, you did talk about a dangerous mix brought about by Christmas, festive season, and the polls in January. So what medical advice would you give? Because when you go to vote, at least each voter is given a ballot paper and then a pen or a stamp. Should each of the voters go with their pen that they use to tick their favorite candidates? What kind of medical advice are you giving when it comes to elections?
It's observing the same SOPs. Voting itself, if managed properly, is less risky than the campaign rallies. Because when people go to vote, they don't go to camp at the place. And they come over, a time from, I think, 8 to 4 o'clock. And one person is going at a time. So if they observe the social distancing while they are waiting their turn to vote, they put on their masks while they are checking their names. And there is a sanitizer before they go to teach. You sanitize your hands so that everybody who touches their pen has already sanitized their hands. So the voting exercise itself, for me, is not a big risk. The risk is this intermixing with the campaign rallies, with the home-to-home visits, with the as people be in strategy meetings in the night, that's where the virus is going to spread. So if we observe just minimum SOPs on voting day, and then there are no after counting votes actions like some people, they refuse, they riot, they what? It is that crowding and staying in a crowd for a long time. Any crowd which lasts for more than 30 minutes is definitely more dangerous than me just going to tick. And even if there was no sanitizer there, if after I leave, I can wash my hands, then I will be okay. But it is the crowding which is the biggest challenge. And people without masks.
Okay, Dr. Mutsenro, we're also looking at the fact that costs are very high in treating this virus. If you end up at an ICU, say with the government hospital or a private hospital, you can end up with a bill of as high as 5 million shillings. Maybe the government may be able to look after you, but also the government is saying it's very high because the patient that stayed longest at Mulago Hospital, actually they spent 44 million shillings with just one patient. So with this high cost of treatment, it also means that most Ugandans will have to, get their own treatment from home. They'll have to find a way of looking after themselves where, medics cannot reach them. How would you advise people to survive this virus if they find themselves at home and sick and cannot afford treatment at these hospitals where the prices are too high for them? How do you advise the survival? What's the survival method?
First, the ministry has given some guidelines.
Mm-hmm.
We know that the majority of people, like 80%, get a relatively mild disease. Some don't have symptoms, but quite a proportion have symptoms, but they are not severe. They are not very severe.
Mm.
Although some of them, if not handled well, they can continue and become very severe and even go to critical.
Mm.
So the first thing of level one is avoid getting infected in the ways that I have already repeated so many times here.
Yes, please.
But I know that there are many who have found themselves infected, not because of their carelessness, but because of the network that you work with. Somebody comes in the office, but they went for a nightclub, or they were at a funeral, then they infect you. And the first thing is take care of your immunity.
Mm.
Now, we are going to have a huge problem. People are eating and drinking all sorts of things.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, and you are going to see a very sharp increase in the people complaining of peptic ulcers, and a lot of stomach problems, and people are poisoning themselves because we are drinking very dangerous concoctions, which end up poisoning the body. Now, just allow me enough time to explain to Ugandans what we really need to do.
Okay.
One, you want, all this you're doing is you are building your immunity.
Mm-hmm.
Now, building your immunity does not mean you have to take concentrated things, because your body needs most of those things like vitamins. It needs them in small amounts. It doesn't need them in large amounts. Secondly, you don't have to take them all together.
Mm.
Because people are blending lemon with ginger, with turmeric, with tamarind, with red pepper, and guava leaves, and they are drinking all this corrosive stuff. If you eat your lemon, or take your lemonade, put it in your tea or something, at that time, that's enough.
Okay.
You don't have to make things to take them. Take your garlic with your meals. You don't. There is nothing different if you eat your garlic or you mix it in that drink. Put your pepper in your food. You can put your ginger in your tea at separate times so that you don't put this very concentrated thing in your stomach. And some people are drinking it first thing in the morning when the stomach is empty. So friends, when they tell you that eat these things, they improve your immunity, we are not meaning that you should mix all of them in one glass and drink. You are causing other problems. Just take some ginger and put it in your tea or in your drink. Later, eat something else. And most of the things, you can take them after you have eaten something else solid in your stomach. It helps to improve the immunity, but you don't need very high concentrations of them. So take yourself by making sure your immunity is strong, by those things are good. Eat vegetables, have a balanced diet, eat an egg, so that you're not missing certain vitamins. But then if you fall sick, we're also having a lot of challenges with people taking hydroxychloroquine. They are taking azithromycin on their own. We have a big problem with the medication. So we have requested, and I think the Minister of Health has already revised the guidelines so that you know what to take when should you find yourself sick.
Okay.
But there is a stage at which, if there are people, we advise to make sure you find a hospital which treats COVID patients as soon. One, if you already have diabetes, it does not matter whether your disease is mild. The moment you test positive, first of all, if you suspect, test quickly. Then the moment you test positive, make sure you get admission, because your condition can turn very swiftly.
Mm-hmm.
If you know you have high blood pressure, that person, even if you are mild, still make sure that you are in a hospital.
Okay.
If you are already on treatment for something like a cancer, HIV drugs, make sure you are in close contact with a doctor who understands COVID, or you are in a hospital. Those are special people. We call them, they are really susceptible to severe disease. Mm-hmm. And you may die in a very, very short time. If you are mild, then there is a prescription. Take your vitamin C. Again, people are taking a lot of vitamin C. Vitamin C is an acid, and it will corrode your stomach if you take, people are chewing as many as 10 tablets at a go.
Wow.
Just make sure you can chew that one tablet at a time. And if you take in too many, the body cannot absorb them. Take your two tablets times three in a day, and it will help. Don't increase the medicine. Mm-hmm. There are practices of steaming. Steaming is a therapy for respiratory issues since we were young. When I was young, when we had, we have always had these flus which are difficult. Our parents would cover us. It definitely helps you to breathe. But should you find yourself getting breathing problem, breathing difficulty, what it feels like the air is dry. It's not that you're coughing, it's just that it's hard for you
to breathe.
Your body is demanding more air, and you can't, you are trying to push your breath inside and it's not going in. Should you find yourself feeling like you're so tired, you are out of air, you can't breathe, you need to get to a treatment center quickly. The ministry is working very hard to expand treatment capacity.
Okay.
And have, because most of those people get treatment issues, I mean breathing issues, they need to be on oxygen. Because now our air here has 21% oxygen. Now, when you, they can move you up to 100% to just help your body that whichever little air is getting into your lungs, there's some a lot of oxygen so you can be kept alive. Because most people will go to the treatment center when they already, we call it desaturation. That desaturating, that means the blood, the oxygen in your blood is already going down. I advise people to find, there is a little gadget called the oximeter. It measures oxygen in your blood. It costs like 100,000 in most pharmacies. It's a small one. It uses batteries, so you can have it everywhere. So you just put it on your finger, and where I am in the office, and I left mine, I'll show you. You just put it on your finger. You don't need to pierce anything or to check in your blood. You put it, and you've seen it in hospital, and then it can tell you how much oxygen is circulating in your blood.
Okay.
The moment that oxygen is below 90, then you know there is an issue.
Okay.
And if you're already COVID positive, you should be going to the hospital.
Okay, doctor, speaking of steaming, how often should it be done, and how should it be done? Because it has been talked about as one way of preventing and treating COVID. How often should it be done? Once, thrice a day? And how should we go about it?
Can you repeat that question, please?
Okay. Steaming has been talked about as one way of prevention and treating of COVID patients. But we lack somebody who takes us through how often it should be done and how the entire process of steaming is.
Of steaming.
Yes.
Now, usually, steaming is usually done, it's a traditional measure, but many people have done it in the morning and in the evening. Basically, when you have cold affects the respiratory system. And for some people, like those who have allergies and asthma, when you have cold, then your breathing system will swell and kind of close, they constrict. So many times that's why when you have flu, you tend to open your mouth so that you're breathing through both your nose and your mouth, and you're congested because, not because there is a lot of mucus, but because the membranes inside are swollen. Now, cold is a stressor. When you experience cold, it causes stress and the mucous membranes, and they swell. When you have heat in there, it causes them to relax. So that's just the science. It causes so sometimes when you have a cold, you get your cup. I have my tea here. You get your cup and you just put and breathe in the steam.
Okay.
It will help to open up your system.
Mm-hmm.
So usually you can steam when it's cold in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
You can steam in the, but some people are putting in too many things.
Okay, so what would you advise is put in the hot water?
I have found that because when they are steaming, it is usually the oils, the volatile oils in those things.
Mm-hmm.
So eucalyptus is already known that it has some vapors. So when you put eucalyptus leaves in some, don't overput. Again, don't overput. You just need a few. We also know that the young mango leaves also have oils.
Okay.
And orange or lemon, they also have some oils. Guava also has some oils. And then there is this plant, what is it called? We use it, it smells a lot. In my language, we call it insonga. I don't know how the Baganda and other people call it. But it's a shrub which grows and smells a lot. They have oils, they have volatile oils in them. So when you steam, they come out in the air and they have that effect on your system. Apart from the heat, they help you a bit. And that can help your lungs to slow down the congestion or the constriction.
Mm-hmm.
But there is a stage. Now, this helps the mild cases. If you're not, don't stay at home when you're having breathing difficulty. There is breathing difficulty from the nose when you have to open your mouth, you feel you need to blow your nose. But there is breathing difficulty which comes from a heavy chest. When your chest is, you just feel like you are pushing in air, but it is not going.
Mm.
You'd see your, now that one, steaming is not going to help you.
Mm.
Go to the hospital, you need oxygen. So steaming is just like a kind of our village way of improving oxygen intake.
Mm.
But once you start having breathing difficulty, like you have been running so much and you just can't, please just go to the hospital because you need to be on oxygen. Mm. Most patients who cross that level, they go to the high dependence unit.
Mm.
If you remove the patient from oxygen, even for 5 minutes, they'll be gasping like they have been locked in a chamber where there is no oxygen. So many people are also delaying at home.
Mm.
So these steamings, these garlic, this vitamin C, and making sure you take Panadol and take the prescribed medicines, which are distributed by the Ministry of Health, the flyer, there are this information there. This is what you take for so long if you are in home care. Those ones work for the mild cases.
Okay.
Mild to moderate. But if you get especially breathing problems, get to the hospital. Let the hospital try to find for you a unit where they will put you on oxygen.
Mm. And also,
really oxygen is the medicine we have now. The medicine we have is oxygen.
Okay, Dr. Musenere, I wanted to ask, is there any plan for mobile treatment? Does the government have any plan for mobile treatment of people who may have COVID, like if you have to treat them from home? Is that something that's even being considered?
Now, the challenge I've told you is that treatment is oxygen.
Mm-hmm.
So unless you are going to have oxygen supply in every home,
mm-hmm.
home care is for mild cases.
Okay.
And they are linking, the moment you are positive, they will link you to a health officer. I don't know how well it is working, but the plan was to link you to a healthcare officer whom you can call and say, this is how I'm feeling. Now, what should I do? And there is a stage at which when you call them, tell you, please get to the hospital.
Okay.
Get to the hospital. Now, mobile treatment, I think that is more of telephone treatment. Because once you go beyond a certain level, you need the oxygen. And at the moment, maybe there are people who can afford to have oxygen cylinders. But even then, in high dependence units, it's not the normal oxygen cylinder they put you on. It has to be a high flow of oxygen. The good thing with COVID is if we don't get too many people infected at a time, which is what we've been fighting for as healthcare workers, we know that many people get infected, but they shouldn't get infected at a go. So if we don't get too many people and you get to the treatment center, the people who get to the treatment center, the death rates are quite low. That's why the numbers we report are low. But we are also aware that there is a lot of people who are not getting to the treatment center and they are dying. And those ones, the death rate is very high because they are not getting to the treatment, because there is a period within which you need oxygen. If you can be supported with the oxygen and you survive those 5 or so days, you will survive. But if you don't have oxygen, you will not survive.
Okay, so would you think another lockdown would help? Like, we've been toying this idea. We've had, there were some rumors, and then these rumors were actually dismissed by the government. But do you think another lockdown, if enforced, would actually help?
As you can imagine, I'm one of the people who pushed for lockdown early, but I had my reasons. But as a disease control expert, at this point, lockdown will not help.
Okay.
No, it will not help. Why? Because the virus has gone everywhere. It's circulating in microenvironments, and even if you lock down, people will move in those areas. It's like bees. You are fearing bees to come inside and harm your children. But now the bees, there are many bees in the house. Locking doors is not going to help. Right now, it is to you as an individual. As an individual, you have responsibility to make sure you understand the SOPs, you understand how to boost your immunity, you understand and observe, because many people know, but they don't do. Put on your mask all the time. Put on your mask when you're talking. Don't go to people reaching out, then lowering your mask. That makes you vulnerable. Two, make sure that you're doing the best to keep your immunity boosted. Number three, if you feel sick, get tested and get health care if you feel the symptoms. Now, there are many people who don't want, they think that their parents or their elderly people, they don't, when they die, they don't want to associate them with COVID. So they will see this poor old lady or old man gasping and really struggling, but they don't want them tested. Because they don't want at death for people to say the person died of COVID, and so they can bury normally. Now, just closing your eyes and pretending it's not COVID, you're even going to infect more people. We have had families who have lost a chain of people because of that kind of thing, and they don't want to admit that it's COVID. But COVID is a disease, it is here. None of us made it. It is here, and that's why the government invests heavily in the healthcare to try and take care of you. Don't pretend. And most of the poor villagers who are elderly, who are going to get infected over Christmas and because of campaigns, it's none of their fault. It's the young people in the house who are going to either bring in the COVID, they are going to go out rallies and bring in the COVID. Get them treatment. They will recover if they can be helped early, detected early, treated early.
Well, thank you so much. Yeah, thank you so much, Dr. Musenero, and we hope to have you more often here discussing COVID so we can be able to beat this. Please remember that over 230 people have so far died of COVID-19, and over 30,000 people have so far been infected. The virus is with us. We are being advised to social distance, to wash our hands, to wear our masks, and especially not to go to the villages. So we thank you so much, Dr. Musenero, for joining us, and hope to have you next time with us. Right now, we will go straight up to take a break, and when we return, we'll be continuing with the program. Thank you very much.